Slokamenam Surajagu Tam Tektu Kama Mamatam Bhartustyaga Visankita Nama Nirvachanam Tasya Shlokamenam Surajagu Tam Tektu Kama Mamatam Bhartustyaga Visankitam Nama Nirvachanam Tasya Shlokamenam Surajagu. Please chant. Mataji. Word to word meaning. Tam, that newly born baby. Tektu Kama, who was trying to avoid. Mamatam, unto Mamata. Bhartu Tyaga Vishankitam. Very much afraid of being forsaken by her husband because of giving birth to an illegitimate son. Nama Nirvachanam, a name giving ceremony or Namakaran. Tasya, to the child. Shlokam, words. Enam, this. Surah, the demigods. Jagu, enunciated. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Jagatguru Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Translation. Mamata was very much feared being forsaken by her husband for giving birth to an illegitimate son. And therefore, she considered giving up the child. But then the demigod solved the problem by enunciating a name for the child. Purport. According to Vedic scripture, whenever a child is born, there are some ceremonies known as Jat Karma and Namakaran, in which learned Brahmanas immediately after the birth of the child make a horoscope according to astrological calculations. But the child to which Mamata gave birth was begotten by Brihaspati irreligiously. For although Mamata was the wife of Utathya, Brihaspati made her pregnant by force. Therefore, Brihaspati became Bharta. According to Vedic culture, a wife is considered the property of her husband, and a son born by illicit sex is called dwaja. The common word is still current in Hindu society for such a son is dogla, which refers to a son not begotten by the husband of his mother. In such a situation, it is difficult to give the child a name according to proper regulative principles. Mamata, therefore, was perplexed, but the demigods gave the child the appropriate name, Bharadwaj, which indicated that the child born illegitimately should be maintained by both Mamata and Brihaspati. Please repeat the translation. Mamata very much feared being forsaken by her husband for giving birth to an illegitimate son. And therefore, she considered giving up the child. But then the demigods solved the problem by enunciating a name for the child. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuran Melitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Guru Nuvaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagra Jatam Sagana Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamsha Namam Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschata Deshatarine Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namine Gauratushe Nama He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namastute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrijvanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataru Bhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhayvacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnebhyo Namo Nama Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So we are reading from Canto 9, chapter 20, entitled The Dynasty of Puru. And then today's verse, Mamata being very much feared, being forsaken by her husband for giving birth to an illegitimate son, and therefore she considered giving up the child. But then the demigod solved the problem by enunciating a name for the child. So, we are discussing this chapter which talks about the dynasty of Puru. And we saw in the first few verses which talks about the various kings. We also saw interesting things in the first verses, few verses of this chapter which talks about that how there were Kshatriyas kings and they had Brahmana's son, and some of the Brahmana's son they also got Kshatriya king. So this caste system was not according to the birth, but was according to the activities, like we read in Bhagavad Gita, Chaturvarnya Maya system, Guna Karma Vibhagasa. So the division is on the basis of Guna and Karma, not according to the birth. Not that just because someone has taken birth in a Brahmana family, he's a Brahmana. So we saw in those few verses that although kings, but they got Brahmana sons, and then some Brahmanas, they got kings, Kshatriyas as their son. And later on, it's described about Dushmanta and Sakuntala, and how Sakuntala, who's a daughter of Vishwamitra Muni and Menaka, she was left in the forest, and then Kanva Muni raised her. And later on, when Dushmanta comes in the forest, he sees Sakuntala, and they have marriage according to Gandharva Viva, and then Sakuntala becomes pregnant. And later on, Kanva Muni does all the purificatory rituals, and the son was born, who is almost like a expansion of the Lord, a representation of the Lord, who is having extraordinary powers, who is playing with the lion. And later on, Sakuntala brings this son to the kingdom where Dushmanta is there, and who refuses to accept the Sakuntala and the son as the wife and his own son. And then there is a woman in the sky where they hear a heavenly voice which tells that, no, this is your son, accept the son, and this is your wife. And then Dushmanta, he accepts. And then the son is known as King Bharata. And later on, Bharata is a very powerful king who is ruling in the whole universe. And he does amazing activities. He is not giving protection to the living entities on this planet, but he is ruling the whole heavenly, whole the universe. And even he gives protection to the demigods. Their families were kidnapped by the demons in Rasatal, and Bharat Maharaj even protects them and sends them back to their respective demigods. So Bharat Maharaj also does a lot of yajnas, he does a lot of sacrifices on the banks of Ganga and Yamuna. He did a lot of horse sacrifices. And in those purports we saw that Prabhupada explained the importance of performing sacrifices and focusing more on the current yuga. The sacrifice in current yuga is chanting of the holy names, Harinam Sankirtan. So in this way, Bharat Maharaj ruled for a very long time, and he had three wives, and he got three sons from those wives. But the queens realized that these sons, they don't resemble their father, and they became very fearful that what if, you know, Bharat Maharaj, what he will think, that he may even abandon us for such child. So out of fear, the wives killed those children. They killed those children. And now Bharat Maharaj had like no one to take the kingdom ahead. No children are there. So then Bharat Maharaj does again sacrifices, and he prays to the Marutganas, and he is doing this yajna, requesting for a child. And the Marutganas, they bring a child to him, and this child is known as Bharadwaj. So here, in the last few verses of this chapter, we read about that how this Bharadwaj took birth, how he came into existence himself, how he has taken birth. And then, so that is being disclosed here, that how Bharadwaj took birth, who later on became the heir for King Bharat. So, as we heard on Sunday also from His Grace Tamal Krishna Prabhu, the background of this birth of Bharadwaj. So one time the priests of the demigod, Brihaspati, he was very much attracted by his brother's wife, Mamta. He got very much attracted, and he wanted to have a sexual relationship with Mamta, who was already pregnant at that time. But Brihaspati, too much affected by the lusty desire, as Prabhupada explains in the previous purport, that the sex impulse is so strong that it can agitate even a learned personality like Brihaspati. So Brihaspati, so much agitated by the sex impulse, he wanted to have union with Mamta, who was his brother's wife and already pregnant. So still Brihaspati had this union, because of which immediately a child was born. And because this child was born, the son was born out of illegitimate relationship. This is like an illicit relationship. So the word used for such child is dwaja. The child born out of illicit relationship. And when child was born, then Mamta as well as Brihaspati both refused to take care of the child. Mamta said to Brihaspati that this is your child, you take care. That the word used is bhara, you maintain this child. And Brihaspati says to Mamta, which comes in the next verse, Brihaspati said to Mamta, "You foolish woman, although this child born from the wife of one man through the semen discharged by another, you should maintain him." And in return, Mamta also said same thing. Upon hearing this, Mamta replied, "O Brihaspati, you maintain him." So after speaking in this way, both Brihaspati and Mamta both left. And there was like no one to take care of the child. So the word maintain, the word bhara means you maintain. And dwaja means the one who is born out of illicit relationship. So that's how the child got the name Bharadwaja. So when this child was born, Mamta was very much feared being forsaken by her husband for giving birth to an illegitimate son. And therefore she considered giving up the child. So that was the Vedic culture, where naturally the woman would have these qualities of shyness, chastity, fear. This fear is not like this was the natural fear, because they were always dependent on their superior. Like we know that a woman has to be protected always at different stages of her life. When she is young, she has to be protected by her father. When she is grown up and she is married, then she is protected by her husband. And when she gets some young children and the husband takes vanaprastha and sannyas, then the woman is protected by her grown-up son. Shri Shri Radha Ras Bihari Ki Jai, Shri Shri Sitaram Lakshman Ki, Shri Gaur Nitai Ki, Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada Ki. So here we see that Mamta, she became very fearful that now this son is born because of our illicit relationship. And if my husband may reject me. So she was very fearful. And that's why she didn't want to keep the child with her anymore. So that fear was there, because of which they were always dependent. They were always subordinate to their superiors. And that's how was the Vedic culture. To the men, they would always depend on the, or always aligned to their spiritual master. So the man or the husband would always accept spiritual master's teachings, their directions, and work under their guidance. And the woman, they would always be subordinate to their husband, and they would have that fear. That culture of divorce was not there. Now we see, like Vedic time, they would be protected by husband, father or son, and that would make them very happy. But now, because of the desire of living an independent life and enjoy independently, you know, why to depend on someone? So they don't want to have that protection of the father, husband or son, and they want to live independently without any such boundaries, because they feel that limits them, and it's very common in the modern civilization. So when, and it's not natural for a woman to remain protected, so ultimately then the government has to provide protection. That's why we see all around, government has to make a special woman protection department. Like we see there are vehicles of Mumbai police, they have this special cars, woman protection cell. And similarly in the trains, in the metros, everywhere there are special coaches for the proper protection of the woman. You know, we never find vehicles which are like men protection cell or special coaches only for the men. You know, because they can take care of themselves. You know, but women are very vulnerable to get exploited, and it's very common in the modern civilization, in the corporate world. There's so much of exploitation. But just to have independence from the husband or father, or son, and not to depend on them, unfortunately, they are being exploited outside. Women are exploited outside. And there are illicit relationships. There's so much of divorces. So here we see Mamta has that fear that she may be forsaken by her husband. But in today's scenario, such fear doesn't exist. Even now, today's, before going for a marriage, the man has a fear. They have fear. Nitai Madhav Prabhu goes sometime for many times into fundraising. So he was telling me, he went to meet one person who is around 36 year old, and he has got hundreds crores of properties, you know, from inherited from his grandparents. So he's 36 year old and he's not getting married. He's saying, if I get married, and after some time, if my wife asks for divorce, you know, this property is not my property. I am the only son. I am only heir. But this all has come from my grandparents. And if my wife asks for divorce, then she will just take in maintenance half of my property, you know, or a good amount of property. So I have so much of fear. I don't have faith. Whom to get married? You know, all this property will go away. And that is very common. Like I've met so many people in Mumbai, got married, got divorced, now long these issues are going on. And the women, they also want the divorce cases to go as long as possible, because that keeps on supplying them maintenance from the husband. The government makes some fixed amount which he has to give. And then she has more demands. One person was telling, who is getting divorced, it's like 3 years the court case is going on, and the wife is saying that I will only sign the divorce papers, if you give me a 2 BHK flat between Andheri or Mumbai. I want that much of maintenance, then only I'm going to sign it. So this is a very topsy-turvy situation, the modern scenario. Very dirty and very frustrating for the people. And that's why so much of suicide, so much of exploitation. In the news we were hearing a few months back, there was so much talk of a movement called Me Too, where many corporate ladies, film industry, they were coming out and posting on the social media that how they were exploited by the people who are who's of the society, ministers, writers, politicians, actors. So such names came in the news. So because they don't want the protection of their husband, they don't want to be dependent on the husband in the modern scenario, don't want to have protection by their father or son, then they go outside to have independent life, and with that independent life have all kind of, face all kind of exploitation. And the current media system is also, you know, encourages them. Like earlier, there used to be, you know, like 10 years, 12 years back, when the bikes were only used, or 15 years back, when the bikes were only used by the men, all different kinds of bikes, then there would be ads where the film actresses would advertise, you know, why should boys have all the fun? And they would have their, you know, ladies' bikes, and they would drive those bikes. And that's how it rolled out into the whole, we see in the city now, everyone drives, and then there is exploitation, you know. So Krishna has made this Varnashram system, and in this Varnashram system, men, women, and different Varnas, different ashramas, they have certain roles to play. And when they don't want to play those roles and they want to play some other's role, then that creates a disturbance. Just like if you don't follow the traffic system and everyone follows their own system in traffic, then that will create a lot of accidents. So in the similar way, when people are not following the system given by Krishna, and responsibilities for men, responsibilities for women, then just disturbs the whole system. So in current scenario, you know, there's all so much of chaos in the society, and there's so much of mental disturbance because of this. There are certain things said what women should do, certain things said what men should do. And if they do that, which was in the Vedic culture, then they would be very happy and they would be protected. But when they don't do, then they are exploited. Like we see in the corporate world now, in the modern civilization, women, they feel that they are advancing if they, how nicely they can copy men. So if in the corporate culture or anywhere outside, if men are wearing suit, if they are having formals, then women think, my success is also that if I also wear formals and suit, and if they are into any such, whatever they are doing, they also want to do that. So that's not success, actually, that is disturbing. We never find men thinking, okay, if women are wearing sari, let me also wear sari. That's not otherwise. The copy is not otherwise. Because the system is set. But unfortunately, the women think that if I also copy this culture of suit and boot, then I am advanced. And because of no culture given even to the parents, they think, you know, our daughter, they are not less than men. They are not less than boys. You know, we will also make them engineers. And I have seen personally engineering college, how much there is so much of exploitation and frustration among the girls because of having an unnatural lifestyle to go for such fields. So that's how it disturbs the whole culture. In the Western world, like USA and all these countries, every job has to be offered to men and women. If there are certain jobs which says that only men, then that company can be sued, that company can be called in the court, that how you can create such differences in gender. That is a kind of crime. So even if they have either military job or bus driving or anything, all these jobs has to be open for anyone. There cannot be any differences on the gender inequality. There cannot be any gender inequality. Otherwise, that's a crime. So now, if there are firefightings, and you know, firefighting these fire hoses, they have very high pressure water. And naturally, the woman's body is not as strong as the man's body. So even the woman in like America, they apply for this firefighting job. So the company which makes these fire hoses, they make two kinds of fire hoses. One fire hose is meant for men, another fire hose is meant for women. So those who are women employees of the firefighting company, they use women fire hoses for firefighting. So just see the unfortunate scenario which is there because of disturbing the whole Vedic culture and because of blind leaders and blind vision given to the people by their politicians or by the teachers, by the so-called leaders of society. where we see Prabhupada who would give lectures, who would be so firm and always say that no, women, they are supposed to serve their husbands, they have certain role to play, they are supposed to be shy, chaste, being always under the protection of their superiors, not to live an independent life. And Prabhupada would speak that very boldly in the America, you know, where there was like gender inequality is a crime. So that is how is an acharya. They don't compromise in presenting the philosophy. However, when it comes to give love, care and shelter, Prabhupada was very much equal to either men or women. There was no such differences that women disciples can't approach him, can't take guidance, can't ask queries. He was a father equal to both, to his men disciples as well as to his women disciples. But when it comes to other attributes like management or leading or certain things, so Prabhupada always had such an boundaries what the men disciples should do, what the women disciples should do, and that would protect the whole culture, that makes everyone happy. Otherwise, the whole scenario becomes disturbed. So when there are such illicit relationship, that illicit relationship leads to birth of Varna Sankara. Such children are born and that disturbs the society more, you know. So when, because of children's born out of illicit relationship or without following the regulative principles, then such children also are Varna Sankara, and they're not much more than any cats and dogs and can't do any good to the society. So here we see in this particular verse that when this child was born, this son was born, Brihaspati and Mamata both left. But all the demigods, they came. Because demigods knew that no, this child is not any common child. This is a child which is born from our guru. So this child cannot be just rejected. So all the demigods immediately came to take care of the child, and they also gave a name to the child. And Prabhupada explains in the purport that according to Vedic scripture, whenever a child is born, there are some ceremonies known as Jat Karma and Nam Karana. So the demigods, although Brihaspati and Mamata, they just abandoned the child, the demigods came to take care of the child. And they did this sanskar. So they did the Jat Karma and Nam Karan sanskar for the child, Nam Karan sanskar. Because the demigods understood that this child is not any common child, he is the child of their guru, and the Brihaspati being very, very powerful, he is the guru of all the demigods. So the demigods came immediately to take care of the child. They did not reject him. So this is another important aspect for our community, for the society, that such purificatory process or such reformatory process are done whenever a child is born, like Namaskaran Sanskar, Jat Karma Sanskar. So we find in the Vedic scriptures there are 10 kind of sanskaras are mentioned. And yesterday we are hearing about Srila Gopal Bhatt Goswami, who has written a book Satkar Sar Deepika, which talks about the various purificatory process as well. So that was the Vedic culture. And even the demigods, they feel that importance, that if a child is born, so when a child is born, for that child, this reformatory processes has to be done. So there is a namkaran, jat karma. So as soon as a child is born, and the umbilical cord is still connected with the mother's womb, and the child's navel, according to the jat karma sanskar, that umbilical cord is cut by the father after chanting certain mantras. So now most of the people are not even aware of this Jat Karma Sanskar. But in the Vedic culture, as soon as the child is born, immediately the father will come in the maternity room and he will chant certain mantras. And after chanting the mantras, he will cut the umbilical cord. And that is Jat Karma Sanskar. But now in modern scenario, most of the children, they take birth in hospitals. And hospitals, the doctor do all these things in the delivery room. So there is no such possibility of jat karma sanskar when the birth is happening in the hospital. And the other one is namakaran. And this is performed for everyone, even when Lord took birth, like Krishna came. So for Krishna, Garga Muni came and the namakaran sanskar was done. Even for Lord Ramchandra, namakaran sanskar was done. Even we see in Chaitanya Charitamrita, when Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared, then Sachi Mata, Jagannath Misra, and Nimbark Chakravarti, they all came. They all were there, and Nimbark Chakravarti, he did the Nilambar Chakravarti. He did the Namakaran Sanskar. So even for Lord, the Namakaran Sanskar is happening, and the Lord is exemplifying in his personal pastimes that these things have to be done. This cannot be just avoided. But when these sanskars are not done, then the whole population, many places Prabhupada describes, it becomes very, very low. And especially in Kali Yuga, there is no jat karma sanskar, nam karam sanskar. Then everyone is just shudra. That's why it is called kalau shudra sambhava. The other verse in the scripture says, janmana jayate shudra samskarat bhave dvija. So by janma, everyone is shudra. Either a brahmana son or kshatriya son. Janma jayate shudra. By janma, everyone, by birth, everyone is a shudra. Sanskarat bhave dvija. But by various sanskar, all these sanskar like garbhadhan sanskar, jatkam sanskar, namkaram sanskar, upanayan sanskar. So by various sanskar, one becomes dvija. And then later on, vipra and brahma janati iti brahmana and brahmana. So this is how is the process. But unfortunately in Kali Yuga, all these things are getting lost. But this has a very important role play. Because when a soul which is going through various bodies in different species, the whole consciousness is very polluted. And when the soul goes into the mother's womb, a human body, then all these purificatory processes are meant to purify the consciousness of the soul which is coming in this body and overall to have a very proper child. So the purpose of doing this sanskar is to elevate the consciousness of the child so that it is very much good for the society in general. But in current scenario, as we say in Kali Yuga, this is all getting lost slowly, slowly. However, when we are preaching and this society is growing, so many devotees who are householders, grihastha, they can set such example by following the current, following the Vedic process of garbhadhan sanskar, jat karma sanskar, namkaran sanskar. In Kali Yuga, the situation has become so horrible that as soon as the child is born, like we see in Mumbai, so many daycare centers are there. So after the child is born, the mother wants to resume her job, the father is anyways doing his job. So who takes care of the child? So the childs are sent to, they are sent to crutches. They are like daycare center, and whole day they are in the daycare center. And like morning, the mother is going for work. She leaves the child in the daycare center. And when she comes back in the evening, she takes the child from the daycare center. So if such child who are not given the love of the mother and the grandparents, then they don't even develop any affection for their parents. That's why in the Western world, we see that as soon as the child grows, they hardly have any love and affection for their parents. And now it is becoming even prevalent in our country, So many daycare centers. Because this joint family has broken, no more joint family. So everyone is nuclear. The grandparents, they stay in separate flat. The parents, they stay in separate flat. And when they are working, so no one to take care of the child. And when child is not being taken care, and he just left at the daycare center, then he doesn't develop any kind of love and affection. So it's so much important for those who are following the Krishna conscious philosophy and staying in Grihastha Ashram to practice these things according to Vedic scriptures, perform this sanskar, give proper culture and teachings to their children. We see few verses in this chapter only. When the child, Bharat Maharaj, grew up little bit, immediately Shakuntala brought that child to Dushmanta. So that is also another Vedic culture. You know, a mother knows very well that she can take care of child for some time. When the child is growing, is an infant, 3-year-old, 4-year-old. But ultimately when the child is 5 or 6 years old, then the child has to be sent to Gurukul, or he has to send to further training. The child cannot remain with the mother all the time. And that's why, you know, even Shakuntala brings the child to her father for her further training. So that was the system. And very fortunately, Srila Prabhupada has given this opportunity where throughout his teachings and his personal presence from 1965 to 1977, when he was establishing this whole ISKCON society, he gave this vision. He started also a small few places, Gurukul. He gave this vision, asked his disciples to follow all this Garbdhan Sanskar, Jatkaram Sanskar, Namkaram Sanskar. Personally established Gurukul, asking his disciples that as soon as you have a child, at the age of 5, send them to Gurukul. Like Omaram Acharit Pragyo, Prahlad Maharaj says, so the child is not supposed to be staying at the house and always in the parents, they don't even grow mature. But they are sent to Gurukul and the Guru gives them this training. And that's why Srila Prabhupada established this Gurukul system, so that the Vedic culture can be at least established within the ISKCON society. So the devotees who are connected to the society, they don't have to depend on any outside material schools, but they can give the opportunity and benefit of the Gurukul system. And in this way, first class brahmanas will be trained. They will be trained as first class brahmanas. And such first class brahmanas can further take care of the whole society, lead the society, and even the whole country in general. Like many times Prabhupada would say that we need first class brahmanas. The head of the society is missing. So what is the need of the society is the first class brahmanas. And these first class brahmanas, they are not produced in the modern schools, which are actually slaughterhouses. They are produced in the Vedic Gurukul system. And this Vedic Gurukul system, to preserve and to propagate, is very much dependent on us. And that's why Srila Prabhupada also mentions that I have done something, a lot of things, but still 50% of movement is remained because the whole Varnashram has to be established. At least we set the example, and those who are interested, they will come. So we understand from this verse about how the importance of women always to be under the protection of their superiors and to have that fear of being forsaken by their superiors, which is good fear, healthy fear for them. And in that way, they remain protected. In earlier time, we see there were two cases of exploitation of women, and that leads to destruction of the whole kingdom. Like in Mahabharata, Draupadi was disrespected, and then the whole Kaurava was destroyed. In Ramayana, Mother Sita was disrespected, was abducted, and that led to whole destruction of the Ravana and his associate. So any such disrespect to women that lead to such big war. But now it has become so common. The rape cases are so high, the molestation cases are so high. So it's always good for women to be under the protection of their husband or the superiors. And when the child is born, there should be always purificatory process of jat karma, namkaran sanskar, and further training according to the Gurukul system. Although in Kali Yuga, it's Kala, Sudra, Sambhava, everything is getting lost, but we have that opportunity. This opportunity is there for the devotees in the householder life to perform such things and live a more peaceful life. As Prabhupada has given guidance for all the Varna and Ashrama who are functioning in the ISKCON society. Hare Krishna. Any questions or any comments? The question behind.
हरे कृष्ण लेक्चर के लिए बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. ये जो प्रसंग चल रहा है भरत जी का या बृहस्पति और ममता का, एक्चुअली देवता समर्थवान होते हैं. बृहस्पति जी गुरु हैं तो समर्थवान व्यक्ति कुछ भी कर सकते हैं, उन पर दोष नहीं लगता है. जैसे रवि पावक सुर सर की नाई समर्थ के नहीं दोष गुसाई, जैसे सूर्य हैं अग्निदेव हैं अग्नि हैं गंगा नदी हैं, ये समर्थवान है, इन पर कोई दोषारोपण नहीं होता है. बृहस्पति जी के जो बड़े भाई उतथ्य जी हैं जिनकी पत्नी ममता है, वो तो गर्भवती थी. कमेंट है मेरा, वो तो गर्भवती थी और गर्भवती रहते हुए भी प्रभुपाद जी इस भाष्य में लिखते हैं कि बृहस्पति जी जबरदस्ती वीर्य को स्थापित कर दिए. जबकि साधारण नियम यह है कि जो माता गर्भवती हो जाती हैं तो गर्भवती रहने के बाद कोई वीर्य स्थापित नहीं कर सकता है, संग कर सकता है लेकिन वीर्य पुनः दूसरा पुत्र उस समय नहीं उत्पन्न कर सकता है, क्योंकि 15 दिन तक ही वो दरवाज़ा खुला रहता है, इसके बाद बंद हो जाता है. ममता तो खुद गर्भवती थी लेकिन बृहस्पति जी समर्थवान हैं, ये बलात् मतलब गर्भाधान कर दिए और तुरंत पुत्र उत्पन्न हुआ. पहले वाले पुत्र को जो अंदर था उसको तो अंधा कर दिए, फिर दूसरा गर्भाधान किए, वीर्य स्थापित कर दिए और तुरंत वो पुत्र उत्पन्न हुआ जिसका नाम भरद्वाज पड़ा था. साधारण नियम ऐसा नहीं है कि माता को गर्भवती रहते हुए भी कोई उसमें वीर्य स्थापित कर दे तो तुरंत पुत्र उत्पन्न हो जाएगा, ऐसा नहीं होता. 4 दिन के बाद ही गर्भाधान करेगा तो ऐसा हो सकता है, ऐसे नहीं. तो ये बृहस्पति जी हैं देवताओं के गुरु हैं, समर्थवान हैं, शक्तिशाली हैं, तो इन्होंने बल से भरद्वाज जी को उत्पन्न कर दिए. अच्छा, व्याख्या यह है जिससे रविवार को दिन प्रश्न लोग किए थे कि दुष्यंत के पुत्र भरत जी हैं, तो जब क्या नाम है उसके शकुंतला जी जब भरत जी को लेकर के आई, अपने पुत्र को लेकर आए दुष्यंत जी के पास, तो उसे अस्वीकार कर दिए. क्यों? ये प्रश्न था. इसका उत्तर यह है कि दुर्वासा जी का अभिशाप था शकुंतला को और उनके अभिशाप से ये मतलब दुष्यंत जी स्वीकार नहीं कर पाए. जैसे दुष्यंत जी जब गए थे महाराज कणव के आश्रम में जहाँ वो पली थी, तो वहाँ गंधर्व विवाह हो गया. इसके बाद वो निशानी में एक अंगूठी दिए थे और वहाँ से जब वो चले तो उसी समय कुछ समय के बाद में दुर्वासा जी गए तो वो अपने पति की चिंतन में संलग्न थे कि हमारे पति देव तो चले गए, तो उन्हीं के बारे में सोच रहे थे. तो दुर्वासा जी जब आए तो उनको उन्होंने अभिनंदन नहीं किया, वो चिंतन में पड़े हुए थे, अपने पति का ही वो चिंतन कर रहे थे. दुर्वासा जी आए तो अभिनंदन नहीं किया, उनको प्रणाम नहीं किया. तब दुर्वासा जी कहते हैं तुम किसका चिंतन कर रही हो, तुम जिसका चिंतन कर रही हो एक दिन ऐसा समय आएगा, अभिशाप दिए कहे कि मैं तुझे अभिशाप देता हूँ, एक दिन ऐसा समय आएगा कि तुम्हारा पति तुमको नहीं पहचान पाएगा। तो ये दुर्वासा जी का अभिशाप था और वही अभिशाप दुष्यंत जी को भी भ्रमित कर दिया। तो निशानी में जो अंगूठी दिए थे वो अंगूठी भी गई थी एक दिन सरोवर में, तो अंगूठी भी उनकी भूल मन गिर गई, वो पहचान पत्र था। तो अब इनके पास तो कोई प्रमाण नहीं है। तो जब कर्ण मुनि के आदेशानुसार शकुंतला भरत जी को लेकर के जब आई दुष्यंत के पास, तो ये प्रमाण मांगे, क्या प्रमाण है कि आप हमारी पुत्री हैं? तो उसमें दुर्वासा ऋषि का अभिशाप काम कर रहा था, उनके अभिशाप के चलते हुए स्वीकार नहीं किए। तो जब वो उस अंगूठी को मछुआरे पानी में गिर गई, तो एक मछली निकल गई और एक मछुआरे ने उसको पकड़ा, उसका सर्जन किया, तो अंगूठी मिली, तो उसमें नाम लिखा हुआ था दुष्यंत। तो उस मछुआरे ने दुष्यंत को दिया, राजा दुष्यंत को, और अंगूठी को पाते ही दुष्यंत राजा समझ गए कि उनकी पूरी बात यह स्मरण आ गई, तो मैंने शकुंतला को दिया था। पूरा उनको पछतापया, सारी बातें आई समझ में आ गई और उन्होंने फिर इसके बाद में स्वीकार किया कि मतलब तुम हमारी पत्नी हो, ये हमारे बच्चे हैं। तो दुर्वासा जी के अभिशाप से दुष्यंत महाराज अपनी पत्नी को, मतलब शकुंतला को, नहीं पहचान पाए थे। ये इसमें अभिशाप काम करता है। दुर्वासा जी एक तपस्वी हैं, तपस्वी ऋषि हैं, तपस्वी मुनि हैं, और भी भगवान की लीला में सहायता करते हैं। और शकुंतला जब इसे कहे तो समझ गई, कहती लेकिन धनुष से बाण निकल जाता है तो जल्दी वापस नहीं आता है, मैं जो कह दिया वो होकर के रहेगा, ऐसा कहकर वो चल दिए। तो उनका अभिशाप था, ये भी भगवान की एक माया थी जो उनको भ्रमित कर देती। अंगूठी भुलाना भी दुर्वासा ऋषि की माया का प्रभाव था। तो भगवान की जो माया है ना, ऐसी प्रबल है जो सारे जगत को नचा रही है। माया सबको नचाती है, माया को भगवान नचाते हैं, ये उनकी माया की प्रबलता है। नहीं तो वो वैष्णवी थी, एक मतलब दुष्यंत एक धर्मात्मा राजा थे और उनका पुत्र जो भरत हुए, भरत जी बहुत बड़े धर्मात्मा थे, वीर थे, जो सिंहों के साथ, सिंह के बच्चों के साथ खेलते थे, जिनके नाम पर देश का नाम भारतवर्ष पड़ा है, बहुत बलवान थे। वैष्णव पुत्र का उन्होंने जन्म दिया, उसी भरत जी के वंश में महाराज परीक्षित आए, पूर्व वंश में महाराज पर, पूर्व वंश में ही भरत जी आए, महाराज परीक्षित आए, उसी को भगवान कहते हैं कि ये भारत शब्द आया है, कहते कि यही तुम्हारा वंश है जिस वंश में तुम उत्पन्न हुए हो, तो यही भरत जी हैं। भरत जी तो तीन हैं, एक ऋषभ देव के पुत्र भरत जी हैं, राम जी के पुत्र भरत जी हैं, एक दुष्यंत पुत्र, ये भरत जी हैं। तो इसमें भी कहने का मतलब है कि भगवान की माया सबको नचाती है। तो उनकी माया के द्वारा दुष्यंत जी भी भ्रमित हो गए थे, स्वीकार नहीं किए, लेकिन बाद में वे स्वीकार की अंगूठी प्राप्त होने पर। हरे कृष्ण।
हरे कृष्णा, थैंक यू प्रभु जी। एनी अदर क्वेश्चंस और कमेंट्स?
Hare Krishna Prabhu. I just wanted to ask you this question because I've been meeting a lot of women in various fields who have been working and who've been going out and doing a lot of jobs what men would normally do. And when I ask them that why do you do this, I mean why can't you relax at home, they say but we cannot depend on the men of today, because if we are not economically independent they may just leave us with our children. So what is the solution to all this?
The solution is that you said is true, the unfortunate situation society, but the solution is the training in the Vedic culture. So the men are trained that they have to take care of their wives, and the wife is also trained to always remain in the shelter of her husband. But right now, from the very beginning, the whole training is to have their own future, have their own independence. So because of that, they always remain independent of each other. Whereas the Vedic culture, the men were always trained that Even if the wife is lame, even if she is blind, even if she is not so good looking, but once married, she is now wife for whole life. There is no option. You know, you just be happy with her. Accept it. Accept it as a karma or whatever, but this is my wife and I accept it. And similarly, the women, they would accept their husband irrespective of the situation. And Prabhupada tells the story of, he visited a place where he saw that there was a beggar who was sitting outside the temple and begging, whose face was defaced and was not so good looking, but he was having a wife who was always keeping her neat and clean. So although the wife could have left her defaced husband, beggar, but she continued to take care of her defaced husband who's a beggar. So that was the Vedic culture where women would accept irrespective of the situation, men would accept and they would live peacefully. But current scenario, because of, Prabhupada explains in the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, the system of co-education which is disturbing the whole scenario. The women had to be trained in their houses by their mother. The boys have to be trained in the Gurukul by the teachers, and that will make the things peaceful. So that was the solution. But right now these things are all disturbed.
But at the same time, I don't think we can say that women cannot go out and work because they have no choice.
They are choosing to do that. It's not that they don't have the current scenario is like this. Now if some woman, she who has taken up to Krishna consciousness, who understands the philosophy, and it's up to like how they have taken up things outside. So outside there is no Krishna in picture, there is no picture of following Vedic philosophy. So then they have to do something. What they are, everyone is following someone, so they are following some other people whom they are listening to. How this thought came that I need to work, I need to maintain my own independent financial setup and all. From where this thought is coming? Because they are also looking and watching someone. Someone else is acting as guide in their life, which is inspiring them to do that way. Those women who take up Krishna consciousness, who become devotees and who develop that full faith and who have still opportunity to get married to some devotee and live a life of
contentment.
Live a life which is described in the scriptures, then it's possible. Like there are many women in our society also who are very highly qualified, but they have chosen to be a housewife and take care of the children rather than pursuing their career. So it's a choice, and depending on whom they look, whom they are, who is the person who is ideal for them. So for outside women, they are looking at some other people. For devotees who have taken Krishna consciousness, they should look to Prabhupada what Prabhupada has said. And similarly, the husband also should look to Prabhupada what Prabhupada has said. Then it's possible.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Can I add something to her question?
Yes, please add.
Srila Prabhupada, in his lectures, he often quotes, a husband has to give all protection, psychological, physical, spiritual,
financial,
to his wife. And he has to provide sufficient clothing, shelter, ornaments. Then only, that is called as he is taking care of his wife. The other day, one devotee was explaining, in modern times, the men have become very selfish and they have neglected the responsibility of taking sufficient care of their subordinate wife. And another thing is that because of lack of Vedic education, they have lost the respect also. They don't know how much to respect. And because of this selfishness and disrespectful behavior, the women nowadays are left without any choice. They're sometimes forced to go out and work because they are not providing their sufficient needs, interests and concerns. They are not addressing. And the other day, one senior devotee was explaining that the woman, if you respect her properly, she can be your best helpful person in Krishna conscious or material life also, in happy life. But if you consider her an enjoyable object, then she can be your worst enemy. So this respectful attitude is being lost in modern society in the hearts of men. So the women are being exploited and they are being given, they don't have any choice other than working outside and being independent.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, so stop here. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki.